news, everyone. You're obviously confused and aroused.
Wanted lap dance nachos, and you're listening to Slurmcast, a podcast for no reason. Today we'll be discussing season 10, episode 10, Game of Tones. My name is Michelle Burlingame. Not with me are Tommy Roulette.
How's it going?
Pete Woodward.
That's me.
And our guest today, Martin Schneider. Hello.
Hello.
Hi, welcome. How you guys doing?
Welcome back.
Thank you.
We get you in under the wire. This was a weird one. This episode was real ass strange.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
it had its moments. I mean, overall, definitely not a favorite, but there was some fun bits.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because I was definitely thinking I'm going to be a downer, because I didn't really think it was that good, basically. So, like, you know, I was worried I would be like sort of bringing everything down, but
no, there's a lot of gasping for fumes here at the end.
For
it's
sure.
Not a
but,
lot
yeah.
of goodness
yeah.
in that.
The end of this episode, though, for me, it was definitely a tearjerker. I'm not going to lie. This episode
totally.
Made me cry both times I watched it. So.
Oh, no.
Just that ending, though, the last 3 minutes just got me. That's all.
He just wanted to,
they're good at what they do. They know what they're doing. You mm-hmm. know, they're just weren't enough jokes. You know, it's like, where are the jokes? Yeah.
They are professionals that are emotionally manipulating people.
Totally. Totally.
I was trying to think about the last time I saw you, and goddamn if I can't even remember. So it was definitely pre-COVID.
Right.
What have you been up to in 2020 now that it's almost over?
You know, I've been at home like everybody else. You know, you probably know, you know, maybe Tom and Michelle don't know so much that I spend time in Austria every year. So, you know, in the year 2020, it is illegal for U.S. residents to enter the European Union.
Mm-hmm.
And anywhere
as
else.
Well as many... And many other countries. And so I had August plans to go to Austria, and they got canceled.
Oh.
And of course they got canceled. I can't go there. And so basically as a consolation prize, I will be getting to my Prius and driving to Los Angeles in about 2 weeks.
Oh, sweet.
To stay with friends for a month.
That'll be great.
Who also, these friends are my Sparks loving friends, actually, Pete. yeah, so they've probably seen Sparks probably maybe more times than you have.
I've only seen
so,
them twice,
yeah.
You know, so it's not a hard bar to reach, but I'm jealous.
Yeah, they since they live in LA, they get to see them once a year. In years when music's being played on stages, like regular years, they get to see them every now and then. So I'll be staying with them for a few weeks, and then I'll be actually voting from there. I'll be, you know, I'll be there through Election Day, and then I'll drive back in the whatever wasteland exists after Election Day.
That sounds dangerous.
Like, bearded, you know, I'm sure bearded Easterners in Priuses driving across Oklahoma are going to be just fine. You know, like that won't be a problem for anybody, you know, so yeah.
Oh,
but,
God.
So, but that's part of the reason I'm going is actually to not document so much, but to experience this insane year, you know, with fires on the West Coast and you know, everybody having diseases and then the election madness and pitchforks and the whole thing, you know. So I'll be putting it on my Instagram, but, you know, it's also just to give myself a reason to not be in the house for a while. Like, I've been mm-hmm. here too long, you know.
Yeah. So. It's like we were supposed to go to Montreal back in April for my girlfriend's birthday. So that got completely scrapped. And we just last week, she was just like, I need to get out of the house. And she found this kind of old timey resort in almost West Virginia, Pennsylvania. And so the hotel was like this giant shining looking, probably haunted. Actually, the only hauntings that happened were in room 119. We did not stay in room 119, but I found it and tried to listen for the ghosts. It was
using a glass up against the door.
A thought horn or thought spike?
Thought spike, yeah.
Thought spike.
So we get down there, and the hotel is like it's like 100 years old, so it's a little bit shabby, but the amenities are nice. They had a great pool and hot tub, and no lifeguards around, so you fill up that sparkling water bottle with some vodka too, and then you just hang out in the hot tub and have a great time. Decent restaurants, historical sites, it was fine. But then we did make the mistake as soon as we got there of trying to stop at this flea market they do at a restaurant. And we pull up, and there's it's a sad little 10-tent flea market. It's the end of the season, last day, so I'm sure people had cleared out. But there was not one but two tents who sold primarily Trump flags and no step on snake flags. And I was just like, I would have gotten out of the car. And my girlfriend was like, I don't even want to do that. None of these fuckers are wearing masks. Like, I'm not going to risk COVID on a social, you know, anthropology exposition. So it was like, oh, here's the racist flea market. And, you know, Trump signs every 20 fucking feet, always in front of either a mansion or a shitbox hovel with like a dumpster and a porta potty out front. Whatever. And then we pulled into the little depressed town near there because there was a guitar shop I wanted to check out, which is fantastic for that matter. I think it's called Micarelli Music if you're in the area. Beautiful stuff. There was like one house on this little street that had just a nice, reasonably sized Biden sign. I'm like, that's some big dick energy right there. Like, because you're literally, it's just like, nah, fuck you guys. You're all a bunch of assholes. And then they'll probably get burned down.
I have to confess that, you know, I live in the West Side of Cleveland, and I have around the time that the Black Lives Matter stuff was happening, I ordered for like $55 a Black Lives Matter flag, like an actual freaking flag.
Yeah.
And I haven't had the guts to put it up yet. I don't, like, I feel like I should, but I feel like somebody might just knock at my door and punch me or something, and I'm not really looking forward to that, you know.
I've got my roommate put a sign in the front window. She's, her bedroom's in the front of the house, so she's got a Black Lives Matter sign in her window. Nobody's broken it yet. I did go for a walk last night, and I saw a lady nearby who had painted her entire garage Black Lives Matter, go vote, nice. Biden Harris, like, the entire front of her garage was painted.
On the other end of the spectrum, I saw my first QAnon flag yesterday in Lakewood. And I saw that a beautiful, like, nice QAnon flag. So, like, you know, I'm going to give it, like, a month, and there's going to be, like, basically maybe one on every couple of blocks. Like, there's, you know, this is going to start happening. And, you know, I hope that doesn't happen. But, like, this year, you know, it's just will be part of the package, you know.
Yeah, so. I don't even blame you in West Park. You're just a couple blocks away from where Laura Wimbles lives. And every year she gets the plants stolen right off her porch. I mean, like.
Oh, yeah.
It's a wild, wild West Side of Cleveland situation. So I get, as this episode starts and it zooms in on Planet Z7, you've got the ship that's blasting the tones at the thing.
Yep.
This is going to lead to some questions at the end for me being like, what the fuck? But, like, so clearly you've got this Close Encounters of the Third Kind sort of homage going on. Like,
do you think that's why they used the tone that they used in this episode to kind of make it similar or like a homage to Close Encounters?
100%.
I mean, they did it at the end. At the very end, you know, there's a couple minutes where it comes up very explicitly.
Right.
You know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just always wondered the payoff, what the actual sound is, like why they chose that. I was wondering if it was because.
I think this episode needed a couple more drafts because I feel like it didn't make sense. The payoff stuff kind of didn't make any sense. Whereas, like, if you can already start talking about Close Encounters in the first minute, then there's no fun at the end, you know, when they get to it or whatever, you know. But
yeah.
There was a good line here when they're trying to figure out what that sound that they're hearing is, and Fry says, "It's not walking on sunshine. It's not Foggy Mountain Breakdown. What else is there? What else is there?
I mean, even that little lead up, like they did the twist-a-roo on the professor's good news, everyone, mm-hmm. like, where instead of like, "Have you heard the news? It's good." But like Amy, once he fixes his hearing aids, like everybody's hearing those tones, and Amy's got the schwacked out music from outer space. But I just liked the one reference that the professor made where he's like, in my day, the sound didn't travel through space.
Right.
Cause like, it's a fucking vacuum. I mean, all right. Yeah. There's a little bit of reality.
I did enjoy that. I did enjoy that. So I want to bring up another moment right around here where there's a Shazam reference, right?
Yeah.
So for me as the person who doesn't really follow Futurama, of course I'm aware that it went away and came back again. But I think for me, it's super weird to have an apps reference in a Futurama episode. Like, that's really odd to me. Do you guys, you know, perceive it that way where it's like, doesn't fit or something like that, or too new, or
I mean, there's a whole Futurama episode basically with like a YouTube and Twitter whole thing. So
the iPhone,
and
in the eye,
when they came back on Comedy Central, they really started like pulling in like the pop culture references and all of that stuff a lot harder than they did before.
I think they had to.
Like Richard Nixon and Charleston Chew.
Charleston Chew, yes.
So we have no idea why Nixon is into Charleston Chew. I have no idea.
I think it's
Googled
just
it and I cannot find it.
Is it Billy West that's doing his voice? Is it him or Maurice LaMarche? I think it's Billy West. I mean, I think it's just something that sounds silly to say in a Nixon voice. It's Charleston Chew.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Right.
It's real Scooby.
It's Billy West, yeah.
Also in line with the Shazam thing was the title of the show is Game of Tones. And, Pete sent me the name of the episode, and I was like, oh, that's so weird. Like, it's so new. That's something that they're satirizing something pretty recent, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you know?
And what
that one did kind of throw me too.
But what's funny is that this one's called Game of Tones, and in the in two episodes, Emilia Clarke, is one of the voices on it. Yeah,
good for her.
So,
well, so I just on the Shazam thing, I remember having Shazam probably back at the time of this episode, maybe earlier. What happened to it? Did it just get absorbed by something else?
It's still a thing. They made a TV show out of it.
What?
Yes, there's a TV show on. Who hosts
Jamie
it? Is
Fox.
It one of the Wayans? Jamie Foxx. Jamie Foxx hosts
Fox.
It.
Oh, yeah.
And it's
yeah.
it's I like mean, it's called
Academy,
Beat Shazam.
Academy Award winning actor Jamie Foxx, like, got a huge paycheck for being like, can you figure out this song? Like, or whatever, you know, like over and over again.
So basically name that tune?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Much.
Okay.
And you had to be faster than Shazam. But actually, I recently was, like the last couple of years, I've had an Android phone where, the Google phone, and the Google phone will actually tell you what's playing without you asking it. Like, it'll just say on the screen, like, Walk Me on Sunshine or whatever, without you asking it, if it's playing in the bar you're at. And then I switched back to iPhone, and I was like, where's that feature? And then I was like, oh, I guess I have to get Shazam. Like, that was
I
had to get Shazam.
I think you can just ask Siri. I mean, you can do that with the Amazon one too.
Okay.
But yeah, I'm surprised that the professor found the source or whatever with his long range oscilloscope or whatever it was. But I thought, I wish thought spikes had come up earlier in the last 130 some episodes. Like that would be fun to just stick something in your head and be able to like verbalize. But like, I was almost weirded out by how excited and mobilized the Planet Express crew got just about, they're like, what is it? And they all seem so interested in whatever, when normally it's just like straight up apathy all the time. Like,
right.
You know, but there was the line right in this chunk of it, where the professor's like, well, isn't it obvious? And they're like, no. And he's like, oh, I was hoping it was.
I enjoyed that. That was pretty good.
This is just based on Fry having had his brain scanned. Have you guys ever had any sort of like MRI or CAT scan thing where you got stuck in a big machine to scan your brain?
I've been
not
in both.
Of my brain.
No. Yeah?
I've been in both. Mm-hmm.
How did that go?
I don't know. It was fine. I didn't really have a problem going into either machine.
Yeah?
Like, there's like, you're laying there and you're not even in it for that long where it's like, it has to be that claustrophobic. If you just close your eyes and you just go in, then it's fine.
and then just listen to that crazy knocking.
Yeah, like I don't even remember the knock. I mean, this was long, long time ago. So
I just remember
I
going
terrified, and then I just don't remember, and I blocked it.
You blocked it. Maybe they zapped you afterwards inside the machine. I had to go in for an MRI. Like I didn't get one myself, but my first ex-wife had to get one for something. And I just remember them being like, you've got to take out all your jewelry, both her going into the machine. And then at the time, like I had earrings and all, you know, all kinds of shit. They're like, yeah, you got to leave that out in the other room because like that shit could get pulled out.
Right.
Just boom, you know?
Oh,
when Fry's like, oh, I heard those, and the professor scans his brain, and they're like, yeah, it's from the night you got frozen in 1999. Is this the fourth or fifth time they've traveled back to that?
Yeah.
I mean, like, it's just a well that they keep hitting, and it's running pretty dry. But the weird thing was, Nibbler hasn't been in here for, like, 15 fucking episodes. And him to just pipe up and be like, oh, I was there too. You're like, oh, shit. Like, I thought he was just going to disappear into the you know, distance.
So I was, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. You know, I watched the episode, and it obviously has this, like, this past element, and it's rather, you know, sentimental. And I was reminded, because I think in the prep for one of the other episodes I did, I watched one that involved a dog that would wait in front of a pizzeria or something.
Oh, yeah.
You know the episode I'm talking about?
You did Jurassic Park. Oh, yeah.
I didn't. I somehow figured out that was like one of the most beloved episodes. Like that's basically like they kind of hit the jackpot on that one, you know? So I think maybe they're trying to recreate that. I don't know.
I think this was part of it was a fan service. And I think the whole overall storyline, they probably had at some point to do. And then it was just like, oh, this is good to like put in towards the end, because it really like brought
a lot of
stuff.
It's almost like
a
victory lap thing.
Yeah. As a fan of the show, like it, you start kind like especially the end is a very sentimental, important thing.
I mean, that's where it does share DNA with The Simpsons, which is tends to have every episode be like Bart says, oh, I'm sorry. I learned my lesson. I guess you were right. You know, like for a cutting edge show that's so genius, they often have this too. You know, these two things together.
I don't know if I'd level the terms cutting edge or genius at The Simpsons for the last 15 years or so. Michelle may disagree. Initially, absolutely.
Sure.
I'm a believer up through season 12.
I'm just saying that's like the basic structure of the show is to have genius comedy, you know, in the first 10 years, and then like also this kind of sentimental side or like very like not dangerous side where it's like, okay, Bart's actually a nice kid, you know, like whatever. So Bart, you know, Homer says he's sorry and they remain married, you know, or whatever. Like
so Fry makes a reference to Kaboom cereal. Was that a real thing? Do any of you, was it?
No,
I mean, he remembered
before
his family. Because there's definitely like breakfast cereals that I miss, and there's snack foods that I miss that like...
It's real cereal.
Is it?
It had a clown on it. It had a clown on it.
Oh, that's terrifying.
Yeah, it's a real thing. Real thing.
I mean, that would be... I don't know. I can't even remember the last time I actually ate cereal. Like maybe once a year around this time when the blueberry pops its head back out from whatever Chinese warehouse they've been storing it in, like I'll dig into that a little bit. I like having green poop for a couple days. It's all good. But like this whole thing where they're going to go in and like spectate Fry as they plumb the depths of his subconscious.
Yes.
You know, like the syringe of milk and cookies and shit and the dream pants. Like,
I enjoyed those. Both of those I thought were good. That's pretty funny.
And it's another segue thing, and it's kind of leading into something else that I'll get to. But like, as an adult, have any of you worn a diaper either medically or recreationally?
No.
Me neither. Me neither. Now the reason I bring it up is, I have a friend who at one point was, you know, dating this guy, and then him and all of his friends had a party, and it was like an adult diaper play party. And it wasn't like some sort of fetish community. They're just like, yeah, it's fun. Can you come? And I was just like, this is fucked up.
That sounds like an Edward 40 hands party. Just stupid.
Yeah. Yeah. Just, it was really the sort of thing. I'm just like, that sounds like zero fun all around. I can't even imagine. Like, and she just kind
of
went along with it.
It's a party of everyone just pissing and shitting their pants.
That's and having someone else clean it up for you. That they were doing that.
What?
Yeah. Oh, it was like, hey, baby, can you come and change me? And it was just, ugh.
That what sounds exactly fuck? Like a fetish thing. Are you sure it wasn't a fetish party?
Yes. Yes. This was just a bunch of fucking weird people. And like, not judging, if that's your thing and it's happy and you're not ruining anybody else's time,
I think that's the key.
Go for it.
If somebody talks you into it or something, then that's not going to go well. But it's just like, I've been waiting all my life to do this. I've always wanted, you know, this is something that I'm expressing something about myself. Then yeah, why not? You know, but
yeah, I
make
personally,
sure everybody's enjoying it.
I'd be afraid that a diaper couldn't contain my refuse. Like just from sheer volume. So on that trip that we took last week, like the amount of liquid we went through, both alcoholic and non-alcoholic, for two people, was Herculean. Like, you know, like we were only there for like three nights, and it was got there the first day, stayed three nights, came home. We probably went through about 10 gallons of various fluids as intake. And we're scraping fumes as we were driving away. It was just like, we got just enough. So like when I've got to get rid of my chemical waste that my fantastic factory is making, like sometimes it's a lot. I don't know. The syringe of milk and cookies thing I liked because that, you know, for something that they haven't really delved into too much for like a space age futuristic thing, like that was always the, you know, like the Jetsons trope sort of like, oh yeah, here's your food. And it's just like a couple pills. Really, I mean, going back to Willy Wonka even.
Yeah.
You know, the gum that tastes like a three course dinner. And right. I mean, I guess right. We have like protein shakes or RX bars or whatever, but I feel like that's the piece that's missing. Like having just one swallowable pill that contains all of your nutrients.
Yeah.
I mean, there are those weird hangover bars. I don't think they've made it here, but they're definitely in California where like you go in and they give you IV fluids to like.
Yeah, they give you a banana bag
after a bad night. It's real weird.
Oh my God.
It's called a banana bag.
So on a less, you know, like at a certain point, the professor says, oh fuck. Is that something he just says a lot, or was this the only time he's ever said it? Like, I kind of loved it. Oh,
I feel
fuck.
Like he said fuff before.
Yeah, he's got a lot of old timey consarnate kind of talk that comes mm-hmm. up and down. But at this point, go ahead. I'm sorry.
There was a pointed like object in the middle of their little setup, which was like, I think it was a surge protector. They really wanted you to see the surge protector in the middle of the room. Did you notice that on
no.
the ground? Yeah, it's like an old school like big ass like brick that everything's plugged into, and I don't really, and it looked like some kind of, I don't even know, like some product. I don't know. It's just weird.
Looks like a nice fire hazard to me. Like I kind of like
this?
Those.
When they were
in the lab giving him the syringe and all that.
Like, oh, okay.
Every time they cut to that room, there's this thing in the middle that they're all. It's like just a surge protector thing, and it's just a joke on technology, I think.
Well, like, I guess the one joke in this that kept coming back and kept coming back, and they beat it into the damn ground, was like, anytime there was any kind of noise, you're just like, is that it? Is that it?
Right.
And like, that, it got real old. Like, the one time the professor yelled at Fry, and he's like, not even close, you tone deaf moron, was beautiful. But like, that just got so old so fast. But some
it's
of
true.
Those reminiscent scenes, like the thing where it's my old apartment and my old turtle and my old burrito and my old girlfriend, and then getting into the argument with Michelle where she's like, lots of young people have false teeth.
Yeah.
You know, that was all lovely.
In his room, he has a muscle lady calendar. Do you notice that?
I did.
He's got,
yeah,
like a calendar, like a, which I thought that was pretty great.
Yeah, I mean, I forgot that Michelle lived with him. Like, I know she dumped him on the night that he got frozen.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly, because that happened again in this episode. But like, you know, even when he's like, "Hey, if it's a dream," and then Leela's just like, "Move on." That was good too. Or what? Move it along. So, you know.
So there was something kept happening in this episode that I thought I was missing something. So like, the first thing that happens when he shows up in the 1999 is that his old breakdancing crew is there, right?
And yeah, then, like, with noticeably so, FAT.
So why is that? What's the point of that joke? Because it's clearly not 1982. That only happened in 1982, right? Like, and then there's a Gorbachev reference out of nowhere for like what's Gorbachev got to do with 1999? Like, was I missing something, or were they just being silly, or like?
Well, I think the breakdancing crew was just a, Fry is a 20-ish adult in 1999 and still has a breakdancing crew.
Okay.
That's, you know, I mean, like, he's retro.
It's beyond absurd. You know, like, and then the dude, I like the joke when the guy decides he's going to be a Wall Street guy after all, you know, that was.
Right, he's not going to go work for Lehman Brothers.
Like, but yeah, I just thought like, am I supposed to think it's 1982? It didn't quite work, whatever they're doing there, you know?
And
but,
his dad, I forget his name, if they ever even said it, but Fry's dad is just like basically sort of a caricature of Patton, sort of George Patton, right. Not Patton Oswalt. You know, like yeah. Scared of communists, military prepper, whatever. So like in 1999, despite the Cold War being well over and not yet the plutocracy that or the kleptocracy that Russia is now, like Gorbachev was still like a reference that he would do.
I noted that
was a dated reference for it, but it's also like all of Fry's weird brain sort of jumbling that up.
Good point.
I have never seen a strip club called Booby Tuesdays, but right. Now I really want to. There was, and I have seen this with my own eyes. I found it on the internet. It existed. It's no longer there. But in Orlando, Florida, there was a strip club called the Booby Trap that had two domes painted pink with red tops.
Oh, great.
Nice.
And I saw this when I went there for my grandfather's funeral, and it was next door to our hotel.
Wow.
Wonderful.
I was 13, but if you Google like Booby Trap Orlando, Florida, you do get some history on it. Like somebody later bought it and painted it black and whatever. I think it's completely dismantled now, but like, you know, if you're going to go for it, like, you know.
On the subject of the strip club, like, you know, I've mentioned I didn't find this episode that compelling, but the second time I watched it, I thought that effect of the white room was actually quite good. I was sort of like, that's kind of bleak. Like, they did a good job with that, like, of setting that up. Of like,
it's a lot more nude in here than I thought.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I was like, I don't know, like, that's good TV. Like, they executed that very well, I thought. You know?
I mean, they did something similar several episodes ago. There was like an episode where reality disintegrated. And uh-huh. So there was just a void left over and they're just on the white board. But I was wondering at this point, and I don't know what the timeline is, but that's almost like a Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind reference. You
good
know,
point.
Where yeah. everything yeah. gets wiped out. So I don't know if it was well, referencing their
point.
Prior thing or the other.
So a few minutes later, when he's back in his house, and then his friends join him, right? You know, then we have to mention Inception, because they're basically doing, this is all a version of the movie Inception. You know,
yeah.
Like, whose dream am I in? And, oh, wait a minute, mm-hmm. Now we're nested dreams, and, like, you know, whatever we do in this reality will decide everything. And, like, you know, so that was, Inception and Close Encounters were the two movies I kept thinking of, you know?
And you mentioned this at the beginning. I didn't catch the actual line, so I'm glad you used it as our intro, Michelle. But like, what would lap dance nachos involve? Would that be like the naked sushi platter where you're eating that off of a naked body? And so it's just like you have a nice sex worker dancer with a pile of nachos and guacamole and cheese and whatever.
I think you're just eating nachos while getting a lap dance. Like, I think you're just
I think eating. maybe the dancer is wearing like a nacho hat.
Oh, so
that would be fantastic.
You're getting a lap dance and then you're just
I would want that too.
That'd be great.
Yeah, that's actually that would be really, really good. Like, I don't spend very much, and by that I mean any, at this point in my life, you know, COVID aside, in strip clubs. But like
I feel like those dancers would have like blisters and like burns
from the
all over their back and their ass.
Hear me out. This is what's coming to mind now, though. This could be a fucking gold mine, and I haven't had a $1 million idea on this show in a while. What if you combined a strip club with a Brazilian steakhouse? So you can get lap dances and then have guys in tight pants, if that's your thing, or girls in tight pants come up with a skewer of hot meat and just start carving it off into your mouth while
you're
getting
a strip steak. Hey,
exactly. Perfect. Yeah. It's the mind boggles, especially now, because I can't go anywhere. So it's like if I could go, where would I go? And it's one of those things that, like I said earlier, you know, we had this trip planned to Montreal. That seems like a place where that could happen. You know, that you got like weird Quebecois and French food and pretty permissive like sex worker laws and stuff. It's like, this could be the golden thing. And I don't know. I should probably go start buying some URLs and copywriting some things. So they kind of jumped through all that shit. Just like, oh, you've been asleep for 13 and a half days and it's going to be here in 12 hours. But then they really kind of cram all this shit in there where it's like, okay, so they see more, like you said, Tom, is like fan service. Like, that totally makes sense. It's like, oh, he's going to have a chance to, you know, reunite with his dog for a while. But then he wiped his nose on the dog's ear when he was crying. And he's just like, which is gross both ways. Like, I wouldn't want to wipe my snot on an animal, and I wouldn't want to wipe an animal on my face. Like,
I thought it was cute.
Yeah. And, speaking of animals, though, I'm not sure where exactly this happens, but Seth MacFarlane making a cameo as Seymour for about 2 seconds. He says one line.
I thought that was his voice.
He does?
So he does the voice of Brian on Family Guy.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't they have a feud, though, or something?
Who?
I don't think so.
Seth MacFarlane and the Futurama guys, or was that the Simpsons, or was it? Does it matter?
No, I don't think anyone had any feud.
I'm not remembering a feud.
I mean,
okay,
they did a crossover. Simpsons and Futurama did a crossover. Simpsons and Family Guy did a crossover. And then Seth MacFarlane's been on Futurama a couple times.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah.
Song. He sang the song in one of the movies.
Oh, right. Okay, like it was like the Moonraker spinoff or something.
Yeah.
All right. I had never heard Gorbachev-ing someone's forehead up like you brought up earlier, but that totally makes sense. I mean, it's an Indian burn, but just like a noogie in your forehead to make it all red. You know, mostly like despite all the emotional stuff going on, like the thing that got me when he went back home is whatever the fuck Captain Crunch casserole is. Because I want to know.
Yeah, sounds like something Fry's mom would make.
but I mean, seriously, that and my girlfriend's a baker. She's got a bakery. I gotta brainstorm this with her because I feel like that's something we can make up. You know?
Sounds like it was probably like Rice Krispie treats, but Captain Crunch.
But you know, like the...
But that's brilliant. Captain Crunch is better. It's already sweet, you know.
For sure.
Like,
and baking it in something kind of wet.
Real quick. I just Googled Captain Crunch.
So did I.
Casserole. And there's a website that comes up, Cartoon Cuisine. And there's actually
Oh, shit.
Unbelievable.
Recipe for that. What they made as
is the, it sweet or savory? Wow. What is it?
Sweet. It's got sweet potatoes, yeah. Brown sugar, vanilla, butter.
Oh my God.
See, that's literally where I was going with it, because like, you know, there's the cheesy potatoes where you put buttered cornflakes on top. And I like at Thanksgiving, I always get like, you know, assigned, you're going to make the sweet potatoes, because I've made up my whole thing. But like, I feel like Captain Crunch, like I make sweet potatoes where I puree them and put in like butter and maple syrup and all this other shit. They're delicious. And I'll make the one with the marshmallows on top to scorch them and make it gooey. But then I'll make other ones with bacon. But I feel like Captain Crunch could be a good topping for that.
So I scrolled down a little further and the photo of the Captain Crunch casserole that they made looks absolutely disgusting.
It
looks like garbage.
There's another link that they tried it again and then they ended. It's basically Rice Krispie treats, but with Captain Crunch.
I mean, whatever. That's low hanging fruit. That's not a casserole. That's a dessert bar. Mm-hmm. You know, like I want something gooey with the crunchy corn on top. And fuck, if you're doing something sweet as opposed to savory, you could use crunch berries. You could use peanut butter crunch. I mean, fuck, you could make a banana cream pie and put peanut butter crunch on top of that. God damn it. My birthday's coming up. I'm going to get that made for me.
Oh, there's also a recipe for poplars.
Ooh. Oh, is it Rally's fries?
No. It's chicken.
Damn it.
It's chicken.
Bullshit. Oh, if anything, they would be like shrimp.
It's just like chicken fingers.
Oh, God. So there's like a whole page on here of Futurama recipes. Yeah. There's Leela's like bean pizza, Grandma Mildred's okay, sugar cookies, the toilet sandwich.
You guys just got an extension. You got an extension. You have 6 more episodes out of that.
Yeah, there's our postscript. Will we get done? I just like the other night as I was winding up my vacation week, I was eating animal crackers dipped in Nutella. And I was like, somebody ought to make a pie crust out of animal crackers. And a bunch of motherfuckers have. It's all over the internet. So,
oh, yeah.
That's, I mean, I feel like that would be highly superior to many pie crusts. But
I've made that before. Yeah? That's Ooh. Usually how I make pie crust is with graham crackers, which is all Fantastic. Animal crackers are, just graham crackers.
But they seem so different. Are they more vanilla? Are they less gram processed or something, or more processed?
I think they're more processed so that they can be pressed into animal shapes.
Even
they're,
better.
They're a little harder. They're a little harder, yeah. Right? Yeah, yeah.
They've got less gram. More flour, probably.
I discovered, if we're talking about dessert real quick, I discovered that they have like the already made cookie like dough pieces that you just put on a tray and put it in the oven.
Yes.
They mm-hmm. make them safe to eat.
Like in the
right
pint.
Out. Yeah. Right out of
yeah.
The
box.
It's like a
uh-huh.
It's like Ben and Jerry's style like cookie dough. I've seen yeah. that too. Yeah.
There's no reason to bake them. You just eat the raw cookie dough. It's
right.
Delicious.
It's made not to be consumed that way. Uh-huh. Yeah.
I mean, you know, I don't really eat sweet stuff. I was just like, oh, this is a thing. I liked some of the family reminiscences, like Fry's having the beer baths with Yancey as adults and his mom is serving them beer in the bath. I mean, not disturbing at all, but, but kind of cute. But I like the whole jump, you know, like flashback thing with his dad where he's just like, what are you scared of before Y2K turns our computers and our waffle irons against us? Like I remember that so much of just people thought, I mean, fuck, like people thought Y2K was going to be the end of the world. And 20 years later, here we are.
If we could only go back and be that innocent.
I know. It's all Office Space all the time, you know? Just steal those fractional pennies off the top of the transactions. There was... So, go ahead, yeah.
We've met his Fry's mom before, right? And so
his whole family.
Was he always so football obsessed?
Yes.
And so... you know, you have to forgive me, but so it seemed like in the second half of the episode, half of it was set in Wisconsin and half of it was set in New York City.
In New York. She was just a Packers fan in New York.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I was trying to figure that out because it's like they were really laying it on thick because she's, you know, she's watching the Rose Bowl, which the Packers are not playing, but Wisconsin's playing. I looked it up. That's the correct score. You know, so I was kind of like,
oh, so that
Wisconsin
was the real
here.
Game?
Yeah, the Rose Bowl. That was the score. I don't know if it was the 1st of January, but that was the score.
The Rose Bowl is always on New Year's Day.
Right.
Why I know I don't know.
They haven't pushed that one out. Yeah, all the other big games, they pushed further to January. But, yeah, so I looked it up. That was the correct score. Wisconsin did win. Because then later on, I was like, oh, there's the Chrysler Building. Like, what's going on? You know, so it's well established that Fry's from New York.
Mm-hmm. Because he got frozen in New York City and then woke up in New York City.
Oh, got it.
So he traveled in time, but not in space, man.
Yeah.
Well, he technically did travel in space because New York is buried under New York.
Mm-hmm.
So somehow they rebuilt the cryogenics place above and brought everything into that.
Maybe it never fell down. Maybe it was on some sturdy pylons to begin with. I don't know. I'm not a master of subterranean architecture.
On the subject of football, I did enjoy the magnetic football joke. I did like when the actual football game's happening, like in the stadium,
yeah.
And the tones make all of the players behave like the magnetic football game.
Yeah.
I thought that was pretty good. I enjoyed that one.
I had actually played that some as a kid, you know, at random weird times. I don't fucking understand. It's like, we're just going to stick a vibrator under a metal sheet and then good fucking luck. You know?
Nobody knows. I mean, is there a strategy? Is there things you can do? No, there's not.
I don't think so. Like, it's a pure game of chance. They should put that in Vegas as like a table game. Or just like you put your money on the thing and good fucking luck. I mean, that actually makes me think of this stuff like, have any of you watched Class Action Park?
Not yet.
No, not yet.
It's real good. And like I had wanted to see it because I heard the Dollop episode about that place years ago. And it totally reminded me of like, there used to be a water park over here in Columbia Station that was super like, just fly by night. And those things of like in the 80s was just like, good fucking, like here's a toy that's shooting like voltage through it. Good luck, kids. You know, I just like that kind of stuff is, I mean, that movie is fantastic. Like just even the archival footage of like Ricky Rachtman doing a Headbangers Ball live remote with Lane Staley and Jerry Cantrell from Alice in Chains in Speedos, where they're just like, yeah, man, this place is the coolest. You know, it was just, it's just bonkers. Like, and it was completely done with like no oversight.
On the subject of, you know, you said the rock and roll connection. Somebody reminded me that Shellac has an album called Action Park or something, which is the same place. That's that place. Like, yeah.
I mean, if you lived in New York and Jersey back then, I think, I mean, and that's one of the things in the documentary is they do have relatively well-known people, I guess, depending on what circles you travel in, at like celebrities. Sure. You know, like Chris Gethard gets interviewed in it a bunch.
I heard that somebody told me he's in it. Yeah.
I think her name is Allison Bird. It's an actress that I recognize from like a million things, but like that was a thing. And it was always funny because like, you know, having grown up here, we always had Geauga Lake and then we always had Cedar Point. And that shit was like, these are the big deals if you're into that stuff. And then my younger sister is 10 years younger than me, and she pretty much grew up in Connecticut. And like what they treated as amusement parks up there were such whack-ass, half-ass things. You know, it's like, yeah, oh, we got a couple slides and a Ferris wheel. $20, please.
I'm from Westchester County, and we would go to day camp, and once or twice a year, every summer, we would go to Rye Playland in Rye, New York, which was fine, you know. You know, it was I feel like at the time we kind of felt like it was famous, but we just didn't know what we were talking. We were just little kids. You know, we don't know what's famous.
You saw it
not.
On TV. They probably had a commercial.
Exactly. And it was, you know, it was big by our lights, but like, yeah, it was, you know, it was fine. But that, for that reason, like we never made it to Action Park, which is probably like Ride Playland was probably a 45-minute drive from our house. And then like the Action Park was probably 90 minutes. So there would be no reason to go there, basically. You know?
Right. You could get the same experience without the airborne syphilis. It would have been fine.
Just found out today.
I guess I'm lucky. I never thought of that. I should count my blessings. I was, you know, what year was all this stuff happening at Action Park? Like all the bad shit?
I want to say like 78 through early 90s.
Okay. So that's exactly my adolescence. Like I would have been 15 in 1985. Yeah. You know, so I guess it's lucky I never made it over there. So yeah.
What were you saying, Tom?
I just found out that the, like, IX Indoor Amusement Park will not be happening.
Well, because the IX, the IX Center is no more. That's shocking.
I did hear that.
I did like the fact that, like, you know, aside from the crew all showing up in Fry's dreams, where it's like it's piling on like Inception, like you were saying. Then Nixon and Agnew, Headless Agnew show up too. And Fry's dad is A, starstruck. And then Nixon's just like, no, I'm taking your hippie son to a real far out. what's he say? He's like, on a real far out musical quest. And he's just like, get him out of here.
He calls him a hippie. Commie.
Yeah.
The commie. That's right.
You know, I mean, I'm glad they really were cramming a bunch of shit into this. Be like, we got 3-4 episodes left. We're just going to get those last little nuggets in there for people.
Yeah.
You know, and obviously they wind up going to Panucci's Pizza, where you can get a large cheese and a Coke for $10.77. but Fry was playing Monkey Fracas Jr. I mean, this is the dumb part of my stupid memory. I remember in like episode 2 of this fucking show, when they go to the moon where there's the whalers on the moon. Mm-hmm. One of the video games in the arcade on the moon is Monkey Fracas. So have we seen Monkey Fracas Jr. before?
No, I think it's supposed to be like Donkey Kong and Donkey Kong Jr.
For sure. Yeah.
Monkey Fracas.
I was always more into Donkey Kong Jr. than Donkey Kong. And I have them both on this video game console that recently shit one of the controllers to death. But it's hard, man. Like my reflexes are so slow, especially when I'm drinking and trying to play video games. Like it's a real bad scene. But I just thought it was weird that like then they have to go through the whole charade of like Fry going all the way to the cryogenics place with everyone. I mean, I loved the fancy rickshaw with Zoidberg pulling it and telling Seymour to shrink down. Like I
love that what Fry could imagine was this really fancy rickshaw that Zoidberg could have to pull.
There were a few things that were kind of like deep jokes. I feel like I can't remember exactly. A couple of things that Nixon said were kind of like, or the professor, like if you thought about it enough, like there was actually something deep happening where it's like a really good gag.
But yeah.
It was sort of like almost for like the writer's room or something. Like I feel like that aspect of the rickshaw was that. Like that's they what just you dream up, you know?
Slip it in. Have you ever ridden in a rickshaw?
Yes.
No.
And I'm not talking about like in Hong Kong or China, like a hippie driven pedicab. It's a vegan bike messenger on his night shift.
I've done it in New York. I've ridden in New York once or twice. Not many times. Once or twice.
I did.
Yeah. It's no fun.
Cleveland, where they're on the bike and they pull you in the back of it. I mean,
rickshaw.
Oh.
I did it. Like it wasn't far. I think it was.
Oh no! Of course, yeah. That's the pedicab. It's not a rickshaw because they're not running. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, I would hope that in those other countries where rickshaws are a more common thing, that they're no longer doing it on fucking foot like that. I'd feel bad enough to have some guy on a bike trying to haul my ass and whatever else around.
They're on hoverboards now.
I'll just take my non-hover car. Yeah.
So around the time they're solving the puzzle of the show, the One, is it Nibbler or his, who's his buddy?
Digby.
His doggy buddy?
Digby.
Digby. So yeah. Digby says, I kind of get a lot of pleasure out of this line, but I don't know why it's funny, but I like it. He says, on one of your planet's many rooftops. Like, you know, like, it's just funny, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, I mean, so like, you know, there's a couple little quick gags where like they're in the elevator and Hermes is just like dying from the Muzak. Like, what? Ah, what is this? But like, but then just like with, you know, this whole thing, because we've been in this same scene like three or four times throughout the course of this show. And it's like, there's the original. And then there was the reveal that Nibbler was there pushing him into the thing, like kind of tipping him over. And then I think they came back again. But like, the, you know, they're even here, they're still beating that gag about like, is that the sound? And then there's a something, I think it's Fry that says, he's like, Amy, I'm deeply disappointed in you. Like, they just can't, they're all tone deaf. They can't tell the difference on these.
Right.
These That's, four
you're
things.
Right. That was a weird, that was like a weird reference. Like, I didn't really know why he was saying that, kind of. But, which brings me to another thing, because the first two episodes I saw when I did the podcast, one of them was Mother's Day. That was the first one I did.
Okay.
And the second one was called That Darn Cat, which is about Amy's dissertation and the curving of the rotation of the Earth or something like this. And I looked it up. And, you know, it seems to me that the professor was a really different character in the one we just saw, where almost everything he says is like, you asshole, like, get it right. Like, I hate you. Like,
oh,
fuck
he's,
you. Like, you know,
he's always
is
crotchety.
He always like that?
Yeah, yeah, he's a grumpy
like he
old.
He was a lot like, I feel like he was more like a nicer guy in the other ones I saw. But, yeah.
Honestly, he was probably just in them less. Because when the professor's around,
I think
he's
the
just kind of shitty.
The one with the one about that darn cat, he's in that one a lot, actually. Because it's about Amy's getting her degree.
Right.
And we see a lot of him, and he's just like, he's helpful science guy. Like, I, what the fuck, you know? And then, like, in this one, he kept saying, like, you nincompoop. Like, I just, it's a funny note for me, but yeah.
Well, even, and then if you saw Mother's Day, like, I think he gets late at the end of that one, so he's not going to be, like, shouting
That's
out
right.
profanity.
That's good memory.
But we get to this point in the thing, and they just shove so much in, but, like, the reveal is Fry heard those same tones right before he fell in, plus he heard two other notes.
Right.
And so... so they see the thing coming, like, well, we'll play the two other notes and we'll respond to it because it's a response. And they go to Mount Shushmore, which,
right.
you know, just based on the pure coincidence that happens with this fucking show all the time. Like, I've heard more about Mount Rushmore in the last 3 months than I have in my entire life. Just
yeah,
because,
totally.
You know, Jackass wants to put his gross face on it.
Yeah, he had a speech there. Yeah.
You know, and then, you know, so this is when it goes full on, like, Close Encounters. And Fry hits the two notes, which are the same notes, just did, after the thing does it.
Right.
But then the you know, the side note on this, the animation on the ship was gorgeous. I mean, they must mm-hmm. have blown, yeah. like, the last 10% of their budget on that thing or something. Because it was
yeah.
really pretty. Yeah. But like then the reveal that it's just the tiny little ship, because we haven't had a sense of perspective,
yeah.
and it's like 3 feet by 3 feet.
Right, just, that was just... kind of interesting, yeah.
And then when it got to this point, like it just got real dumb. Like the end of this episode is just stupid as hell.
Yeah, so it all turned out that the sound that they'd been hearing that was causing earthquakes and all
destroying
that was
planets.
Just the key fob with Digby looking for the spaceship that he and Nibbler lost when they got drunk on Earth after pushing Fry into the cryo tube.
I mean, but yep. also I'll admit that I've walked into like parking garages and just walked around parking garages hitting my key fob trying to find my car.
Oh,
right,
yeah.
Trying to find your car or trying to find other people's cars? Like, are you trying to set, like, that's one of those things about those that's always, like, how do they code, you know, the radio frequencies or whatever they're doing with those things? Like, there's got to be some number where you can start hitting it.
Absolutely a chance that you could unlock someone else's car. But the probability of that car being in that parking lot at the same time your car is going to be so small that it's probably not going to happen. But there's been stories where people have like walked into a car that looked like theirs and they're
It's happened to me before. Oh, yeah. I went to Home Depot with my neighbor a couple of years ago, and we took her car, which is just a plain silver Nissan Sentra. So very common car. I didn't know whether it was her car or not, but she hit the fob. We opened up the doors and I'm starting to sit in the car, and she was like, "This isn't my car. My key fob just opened this other Nissan Sentra." And then like we both thought that it was her car until she opened up the door and was like, "This isn't my car. And
why is there all this cocaine in here?"
Well, she looked over and her car was like the next aisle up. Like directly in front of, so, but her key fob opened up the other Nissan Sentra.
Or maybe she heard her car unlock and that car was already unlocked.
No, the lights flashed. Oh. Like it unlocked and the lights flashed and everything. It was very obviously her opening up a completely different car with her fob. So we just closed it up as fast as we could and went to her car and left.
You should have left like a horrible note. Just like that would have been a great. No. I know what you did. I think we just lost you, Martin. You went quiet.
I said you could take a dump.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's biological warfare is what that is. But I think
burglars are known to do that. Like, just they'll do like, this is kind of a subject of its own, but like, so you can, while you're burgling a house, you can, take a dump in the living room or something just to weird people out. But I heard a variation that I kind of liked, which is a little more subtle, which is like, go into the fridge and take a candy bar and eat half of it and put it back. And like, and then like, people are just like, they just can't get that out of their mind that the guy was
that's psychological terrorism. That's some Golden State Killer shit.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that's exactly what the Golden State Killer did.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that goes back to what are the axe murders in Iowa, the Alaska axe murders or something, like the guy who killed that family, like ate a bunch of the bacon, then used the grease from the bacon to jerk off, and then just left. Like, it's just like, this is a full service stop. I can kill some people. I can molest some people. I can eat some bacon.
Eat bacon.
Grease it up and go to town on myself. That's all you need. Yeah, I mean, even like Nibbler and Digby be like, it just wasn't funny. It was just like, this is getting real dumb.
Mm-hmm.
I think the joke of the key fob, like that's the whole premise for the whole show, isn't interesting. Why is that fun? I don't get why it's good, you know?
Yeah,
like,
it was a real bummer they just didn't reveal.
You know, they didn't add the part where it was like funny, mm-hmm. you know? Like it could have made it more like pointed and they just forgot, you know? That's like
that part is where, like, I don't know where the writers started with this story, like what idea they had that they built around it, because nothing sounded like something was like, oh, we should do this, other than back to his mom at the end of the show so he can say goodbye.
So way back at the beginning of the show, I told you I was a little nervous about, you know, being a wet blanket about this episode. So I was kind of interested to see, like, I went on the Wikipedia page for this episode, and it's, you are informed that the AV Club gave this episode an A-, which struck me as like just bizarre. Yeah. And then, but the second thing is that apparently it was the submission to the Emmys.
It was nominated for a Writers Guild Award too.
Yes, exactly. I think that's what it was. It wasn't the Emmys, it was that. And so it was like, okay, you know, and I just basically, at that point, I was actually confident that three of you would agree with me that this was not one of the best episodes.
Yeah, but what you've actually done is uncovered your secret, Martin, of why you're a good guest despite not being a fan of the show. You did fucking research. Yes. I've never looked up a Wikipedia page for this show.
You also watched the show more than once.
Yeah, so, like
right there, you're a great guest.
It's the COVID times, you know, it's like, what the hell else am I going to do?
Gotta do something. Whatever. Like, you know, everything gets resolved. I don't understand how Fry knew where their ship was, but whatever.
Right.
Well, he's been to the cryogenic lab a billion times.
No, this is true.
He's been there before, so he knows the ship was there.
I think that was actually an example of a subtle joke, because if I understood the plot correctly, 1,000 years have passed, right? And that thing is still there. And the only thing that's happened to you, it looks fucked up, but, you know, the cassette player is gone, right?
Yeah.
You know, and it needs to be charged. Like, there's something not bad there, you know? And actually, I did enjoy that the Bender is required to charge the thing, right?
Right.
Yeah. Bender jumps the battery.
Which apparently is pleasurable. Like, he likes it. He's like, ooh.
Well, yeah, I mean, like, we skipped over it, but Fry's dad threw a grenade in him earlier
yes.
because he thought he was a waffle iron that was revolting on him. At the end of this, Nibbler and the Niblonians, super grateful. You know, they're like, we'll make it up to you, Fry. Just like, well, you can't because time's gone, whatever. And then it all resolves because they put him into Fry's mom's dream and he can spend more time with his mother. So that's great. What I was really happy and impressed about with, though, was when he goes to sit down there, he's like, do you want some crackers and a slice of hat?
Yes.
Yeah.
He's got the cheese head thing on. And fucking, here we are half an hour later talking about lap dance nachos and going into the hat with a snack. I mean, maybe snack hats should be a thing. Maybe that should become, I mean, I think the Brazilian Steakhouse Strip Club definitely should be a thing. I would... like, shut up and take my money. But, like, I'd love to have, because, like, what happens to me is I got my laptop on my lap, I got my phone in my hand, I'm watching TV, I got a drink in my other hand. Like, if I could have some kind of snack situation where I could just pull it off my head.
And there would have to be a compartment in the hat for the little dog, right? Because the little dog is then in the hat.
That's part of the dream. I mean, let's stick to reality, Martin.
I know. I'm just a crazy dreamer, I guess.
I mean, dreams are good to have, especially now.
Yeah.
It was just that was a tearjerker of an ending for me because, you know, Fry got to visit his mom in her dream instead of just seeing her as a dream in his own dream. Heart-wrenching song by Eels. and it shows Fry's mom in bed kind of waking up and looking at a picture of Fry on her nightstand and smiling because she knows, like, she actually got a little bit of closure from Fry disappearing all those years ago. That's what makes me cry.
It's real nice.
I mean,
that hit me in the feels, as they say.
They're good at it, like I said. They know what they're doing.
Yeah, they are emotionally manipulative, and fortunately for me, I've had enough emotional manipulation in my life to be immune to it pretty much at this point. Now it just makes me mad. Oh God, we got through it. There's only three left. We're like this. Well, this could be. This will be done by Halloween.
Oh boy,
it's a real achievement. I mean, you used the word homework before. It's homework for you, like. You know, it's impressive that you didn't just stop doing it. Like, you finished, you're going to finish it. You know,
we may not be the best Futurama watch along podcast, but we're the ones who fucking finished it.
Was it 2015 or 16 did we start it?
It might have been 2017.
No, it wasn't. No, because
I joined in 2017, right?
Because I remember we were recording the night of the election in 2016.
You're right.
You were?
Yes.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's a real bummer of an episode, let me tell you.
Yeah.
Because we started getting early returns. Was that?
I liked that you guys were all like, what could go wrong? We'll just do it on election night. You know, like, Hillary's going to win. It'll be great.
Like, I mean, you know, nothing would have been decided by, you know.
Right. 8:30 or something. Yeah.
But I think that was the episode we did with Dan Bernardi. We started in June of 2016.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
That makes sense.
Yeah. So that's the beginning. God damn, we've been doing this. Oh, wait. Yeah, episode 101 in color was, we put that out in June of 2016.
Wow.
Well, that means we were recording well before that, though, because we put out like, we recorded like three or four before we even.
Yeah, we started recording in like April of 2016. Mm-hmm. So we're a solid 4.5 years in. You know, God, yeah,
I mean,
this
it's your Vietnam. Let's face it, it's your Vietnam. You've been in the shit. You've been in the shit for a while.
We've had traumas. We've had guests disappear.
We're gonna leave.
We've had guests disappear.
Nothing has changed.
We've had hosts disappear. We'd have guests disappear. All of these things have occurred. I mean, you stick around long enough, you're gonna see everything, right? Well,
we do find out, like, there is a lot of bits and jokes that just come full circle and make it relevant, like, again now.
Yeah, even from the original run, it's just like, well, it's like The Simpsons predicting that Trump would, or, you know, saying that Trump was president as a joke and just be like, oh, fuck.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, we got through it. We'll get through it. And honestly, I was just saying to Michelle before we got started, like, almost starting to get a little teary eyed when I start doing my show homework. We're like, this is almost done. You know, we'll fill the void somehow.
You have a break and you take it maybe a year where you don't have any homework, and then maybe you do a different one. You know, the three of you, you know, figure out some other show you like.
I think we should all go in and open up a strip club Brazilian steakhouse. That's honestly, I've never wanted anything more in my life.
You know, what's funny, Pete, is that restaurants are a thriving business right now. I'm sure there's no downside there.
They are. My girlfriend's bakery has been going along.
Bakeries are not restaurants. Bakeries are doing great. Restaurants,
it's a donut / coffee shop, and they're going to be expanding into some other things soon. But it's been selling out every day. It's fantastic. I plan
on doing a podcast going back through Slurmcast and then talking about Slurmcast doing the episode of Futurama.
No. How about you do the Futurama run, but backwards. You now just start going backwards. Like,
we'll just redo all of Horchie's episodes with me.
Like Seinfeld.
Yeah.
They what's his name? Because George's father was played by a different actor in the first season, so they reshot. They reshot them. Shit. Like, that's
That's beautiful. I'd prefer to see Jerry Stiller, honestly. I wish he was still with us. Mm-hmm. Rest in peace.
I think almost everybody involved is like, no offense to the other actor who did a fine job, but like, it's Jerry Stiller, you know.
Yeah.
Moving forward, and you know.
If like, you know, Tom Waits wants to sing your songs, or if Placido Domingo wants to sing your songs, have at it. I'm still going to get the publishing, so it's all good. It's been wonderful to see you just in general, because I haven't in forever, but also to have you back on. I'm excited about your trip. I kind of want to mimic that now.
Yeah. You know, just, you know, watch me on Instagram. And I have to say, it was a pleasure to be doing this podcast with you guys. It is, you know, it's a little ritual that once every year or so I get to watch some weird episode which I'd never heard of before and, you know, yammer about it with you guys. And it's been a fun thing. And so that's why I need you to start a new show. I need to do this in a couple of years again.
And it's something else.
Take your time.
Do you have anything to plug aside from that? Or do you want to give people your Instagram so they can follow along? Or do you keep that pretty close?
If they want, it's Woven Strap. It's WovenStrap. I believe, I'm pretty sure. And like my trip will start around September, maybe like October 1st or something like that. So, you know, whatever. Like the Clevelanders should tune in and, you know, I have nothing to plug aside from that.
I mean, look, and if you're out in Los Angeles or anywhere along the way between Cleveland and Los Angeles, reach out to Martin and tell him to where to go where it's not going to be awful and bad.
There you go. Or on fire.
Exactly.
Yeah, or on fire.
Or on fire.
I'm actually, like, the thing that I'm kind of floating in my head right now, so I have something to look forward to, is a between Christmas and New Year's getaway to Joshua Tree to stay in Kate Pearson's, Kate Pearson from the B-52s has a trailer park hotel Airbnb out there.
I want to go there.
Called Kate's Lazy Meadow. And I have old, good friends that live in Joshua Tree. So just be like, go out there. Maybe I can get a sound bath at the Integraton in a socially distanced way. Go see Giant Rock. Stay at a B-52's Airstream. All for it. So fingers crossed. That'll be my next thing.
You know, when Biden's president, everything will be better. I will say when and not if, you know.
So. I mean, you know, here's the thing. I won't say when. If he loses, when... When the Civil War starts, if he loses,
right,
we just have to fight harder. That's all, you know. Let's use some guerrilla insurrection to, like, you know.
Oh, I have a map already marked. There's an X where I live, and then an X up in Canada, and I just got to get to that.
You just got to follow the dots.
Wrap it up. We were having yet some more love fest with Martin. Thank you again. Safe travels.
You're very welcome. Thanks a lot for having me. And good luck with the end of the show. I'm sure you'll bring it to a satisfying conclusion.
Thanks. So.
Satisfying. I think what's the word? Adequate is probably more like it.
Very good. All right.
All right. So the episodes are at slurmcast.com or in iTunes or your other podcast listening things. You can email us at slurmcastpod@gmail.com. We're on Twitter and Instagram at slurmcastpod, on Facebook at slurmcast. 216-438-1077 is the phone number that you can call and leave voicemails or send text messages of laptop nachos to, and rate and review us in iTunes or something. I mean, come on, send us out with a little gift. There's a couple people that have said some really nice things lately. We super appreciate it.
And made some art too.
Yeah.
Yeah. The fan art that came through was awesome. We're just really bad at following up on putting shit up because the more effort we expend in this now, it just seems waste. All right. Well, have a good week or whatever, everybody.
Have a good week.
Bye. Bye. Bye.